Assaf Likhovski, who is a professor of law and legal history at Tel Aviv University, Faculty of Law. He is the author of two books, Law and Identity in Mandate Palestine, and the second is Tax, Law, and Social Norms in Mandatory Palestine in Israel. He also wrote many other articles on Israeli, American, and English legal history, and probably we'll talk about the history of this.
We were given 7 minutes each, so I'll be brief. And my comment will be about a historiographical comment, because I'm a legal historian. So Jim's lecture is about the entanglement of Jewish nationalism and human rights in the mid-20th century. And the argument he makes in the lecture and also in the wonderful book that he wrote on the topic is that the post-Second World War human rights regime was, to some extent, a Jewish project, and some of the Jewish forefathers of this regime combined in their thought a commitment to the individualist notion of human rights together with a commitment to a collectivist notion of Jewish nationalism, and saw no contradiction in this combination, and specifically discusses two such figures, Herr Schlauterpark and Rafael Lemkin, which didn't appear in the book, by the way, both from the then Polish and now Ukrainian city of Lviv. Loeffler argues that both Lauterpacht and Lemkin were not merely cosmopolitan individualists. Their thought was also rooted in Zionism, which was the ideology that they adopted in the early part of their lives and which they never abandoned. The implicit assumption that informs Jim's book and lecture, an assumption that one often encounters in biographical works, is that people do not usually completely change their outlook as they grow older. The ideas that we believe in as young people continue to inform our thinking throughout our life. This, after all, is what gives coherence to biographies. This belief that there's an essential unity, an essential core in life of people, each period in our life, or the life of the person the biographer is studying, is somehow connected to other periods and all are connected to that person's youth. Loeffler's argument that the Jewish experience, especially that of East European Jews in the post-First World War period, was an important source of inspiration for the modern human rights regime is convincing. Although, of course, one might add that many of the progenitors of modern human rights were neither Jewish nor East European. For example, people like Eleanor Roosevelt, first chairperson of the United Nations Commission on Human Rights, which drafted the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. I will not dwell on this point. In my brief comment, I would like to ask, to what extent can we expand Loeffler's approach to other figures who belong to the same milieu out of which Lauterpacht and Lemkin emerged? There were other East European Jewish lawyers who followed a very similar biographical path to that of Lauterpacht and Lemkin, and also to that of Jacob Robinson, another hero of Loeffler's book, who was also mentioned in the lecture, except that they moved to Palestine in the 1930s, 1940s, rather than staying in the diaspora, like Lauterpacht and Lemkin. So I'm thinking of people like Nathan Feinberg, a Lithuanian Jew who was deeply involved in Jewish attempts to use the interwar minority rights regime to protect Jewish interests in Central and Eastern Europe, and later became a professor of international relations and international law in Jerusalem, and he was also the first dean of the Hebrew University Faculty of Law. Or Mats Lazarson, a legal philosopher but also an expert on the minority regime, was a member of the Latvian parliament, was one of the founders of the Tel Aviv School of Law and Economics, which was established in 1935 and which Tel Aviv University Faculty of Law came out of, and later taught at Columbia University in New York. Although Farhafti, a Polish-Jewish lawyer who during the Second World War was a deputy director of the Institute of Jewish Affairs in New York, headed by Jacob Robinson. And Farhafti was later an influential figure in shaping Israel's post-independence constitutional regime. Or Benjamin Aksin. So Aksin I'll talk a bit more about. Take him for example. Some parts of Aksin's biography were uncannily similar to Lauterpacht's life. Aksin, who grew up in Riga, and by the way, the biography is in Hebrew, so people who read Hebrew, it's a wonderful biography, It's called From Riga to Jerusalem. It's an amazing book. So Alexei grew up in Riga, but studied law in interwar Vienna, just like Lautenbach. Both Alexei and Lautenbach were students of Hans Kelsen, and both were simultaneously involved in Zionist student politics. Lautenbach was the head of the Viennese Jewish Student Union, Judea, and Alexei was a board member of that union, responsible for the two kosher communal kitchens of the union, one of which was run, oddly enough, by Adolf Hitler's sister, Paula Hitler. After obtaining a doctorate in political science in Vienna, Alexei obtained a second doctorate in international in Paris. He then moved to the United States, where he was active both in Zionist politics and in international research, first at Harvard and then as a researcher for the American Congress in Washington, D.C. In 1949, he immigrated to Israel and became a professor of political science and law at the Hebrew University. The Zionist East European international law scholars that Jim discusses in his lecture and book remained in the diaspora after 1948 in the UK and US. What about those who moved to Palestine and later became some of the founding fathers of the Israeli legal system, like Axel? Were they also, like Lautenbach and Lemkin, Zionist internationalists, rooted cosmopolitans who combined Jewish nationalism with a desire to create a universal individualist human rights agenda? Or whether they were they primarily Zionists, fearful that such a global human rights regime might threaten the new Jewish sovereignty obtained by Israel after 2,000 years of exile. My impression, based on the work of people like Rotem Giladi and Eliav Liblich, is that in the Israeli case, one side of the equation, the nationalist side, proved to be stronger than the other side, the cosmopolitan side. Although I must admit that a comprehensive study of this topic has not been carried out yet. This is a group of fascinating people that are certainly worthy of a book, just like your book, about the Jews who remain in the diaspora. If this is indeed the case, maybe we should reconsider the argument that in the mid-20th century, Zionism and internationalism were connected to each other. They were indeed connected in the thought of Jewish scholars of international law in the diaspora, certainly when these scholars were young, but less so in Israel. This should not be surprising, because one assumption of many biographers is the basic unity of the life of the person whose biography you are writing. Another assumption is that the geographic location of the person you are studying also influences his or her ideas. And so a split between the ideas of those East European Jewish lawyers who remained in the diaspora and those who immigrated to the newly independent state of Israel would not be very surprising. The existence and scope of such split between Israel and the diaspora is just one of the many interesting issues for further research raised by Loeffler's original thought-provoking and important project. So I thank you for the book, because it was highly interesting.